17, Pasuk 1. So, if you look at Bereshit, 17:1. Where is it?
When Abraham was 90 years old,
in the middle of the year, Hashem appeared to him and said to him, "I am El Shaddai. Walk before me and be."
Remember, by the way, El Shaddai is the name that Hashem had introduced himself to the Avot, which he tells Moshe about later on in Mitzrayim. The Avot only knew me as El Shaddai, but Shmi Hashem, Yudte Vavke, they never knew me as that. So El Shaddai here, go ahead.
Walk before me and be perfect.
Be perfect. Now, if God told me to be perfect, I would say that's a joke.
Yeah.
What do you mean, be perfect? Okay, or, tamim means many things, but it's not a bad translation. Perfect. So, the Ramban, obviously there's a difficult pasuk. How could Hashem command somebody, walk before me and be perfect? Should I tell my child, the rabbi should tell the community, listen folks, you have to be perfect. All right, so if you see the Ramban, by the way, on our book, it will be veheyeh. Sadik Tet. Do you have that? Sir?
Yes, sir.
Those words, heye tamim. Not, it's in the middle of the pasuk of the Ramban. You have to keep going. El Shaddai is the beginning. And then he goes, Italech lafanai, walk before me. That's we're skipping that. And then become perfect. Be perfect. Where's the Ramban on that?
This one doesn't matter. No, right here.
Okay. Alright? So veitamin. Mitzvah acheret. Od binyan hazeh. Oh, well, he's picking up on hitalech lefanai. What does he mean by walking before me? So for just a second we can go back to that, right? That's also a commandment, right? So he says, Lalechet b'derech asher oreh otcha. Hitalech lefanai means go in the way that I will guide you, that I will show you. Now, usually if you show somebody where to go, he's walking after you, not before you. But so to speak, Hashem is here and he's saying to Abraham, that way, right? Behind him. Abraham is going ahead. Okay? Kitam acharei Hashem alokechem teilechu v'otot tira'u. And he's quoting a pasuk to give you the impression of how you have to go to understand this pasuk. After God, you shall walk. And here we're talking about before him. Ki amitzvah le'echoz darko kodem sheyoreinu. So what's the difference? Right? One of them is to walk in front of you, and the other pasuk is to walk behind God, or to follow God, right? So he says, because the mitzvah to grasp onto the ways of God that he will show you means hitalech lefanai. That means go before me. In other words, you absorb the ideas that God gives you about how to behave, and then you go. You go. You don't need God. You don't need to see God to follow Him, right? You already have Him in you. But if God commands you at this point, this is what I want you to do now. Do this. That means following God's commandment. Following. Yeah, the word in English also is to follow somebody's commandment. Doesn't mean you're walking behind him. Follow means to obey. So there's two kinds of... The Ramban, we once talked about this, so I think a long time ago. When the Ramban talks about a pasuk, Vasita hatov v'hayashar b'enei Hashem. Remember that pasuk? You shall do that which is good and right in God's eyes. That's a pasuk in the Torah, somewhere in Tabari, is it? Do you remember that pasuk? Sita tov yashar b'enei Hashem. You're a Balkovi. So, I think it's in Tabari somewhere. So, everybody asks, well, if you give me a commandment, God, then I know what you want me to do. But if you tell me you should do what is good and right in God's eyes, how do I know what's good and right in God's eyes? I mean, God told me what to do, so I'll do it. Right? But so the Ramban explains on that pasuk there that that refers to things that are not commandments. You shall do what's good and right in God's eyes is not one of the mitzvot that Hashem gave you. It tells you to run through, it tells you to give tzedakah, it tells you to visit the sick, it tells you not to cheat, it tells you to be kind to people. Those are commandments. That's not Tovi Hashem Ben Hashem. It might be Tovi Hashem Ben Hashem, but you already know that. The things he's talking about there are not commandments. So the Ramban has the problem, just like everybody else. If God didn't command in this thing, how do you know what is good and right in his eyes? So he explains there that if you're close to God and you train yourself in mitzvot and you learn Torah and you get used to, after a while, intuitively being able to understand what God would want in a certain situation. And he says you can do it. And it's a commandment to do it. You have to bring yourself to that point, not just to do the mitzvot all your life, but to get to the training to be the kind of a person who could intuitively anticipate what God would want me to do in this kind of situation. Because he can't command you a commandment for every single step that you take. Right? You have 613 commandments. So there are many situations in life which are to at least to the appearance of things is not clear exactly what God would want. But if you get into God's mind, so to speak, previously, you should be able to intuitively feel what God would want you to do in this situation. And then you shall do what God would want you to do. Without being told. And here he's telling the same thing here, right? Italech lefanai means once you absorb what God would be wishing, then you go ahead and go ahead. So you're in front. You're not being told what to do. When God commands you, then that means you're following his commandment. Two different sukkim. Very important sukkim. No? And the other one is by the way, when you shall fear him is actually related to doing his mitzvot, right? In other words, you obey. The other one is mi'ahava, so to speak, because you know what he wants. You know what he wants. You wish to follow, to do what he would want. That mitzvah to grasp his ways before he commands you, without being commanded, that means italech lafanai. Right? But that which comes after commandment means following God, after God. Okay, both of them relate to doing what God wants. Okay, now so that's one commandment. When he told Abraham to do that, he was telling him to behave in such a way, now that you know me, I want you to go ahead in front of me and do my wishes in the world. Right? I mean, quite something. No. There's a medrash that says, it's true that there's a medrash completely different than the Ramban, right? That when he said perfect, veheyeh tamim, that's coming up. That coming, veheyeh tamim means be perfect. Perfect means circumcised. But that's just, I mean, how do you know what's perfect? To be circumcised. But there is a medrash like that, and that Abraham bowed down, he felt embarrassed, until now it wasn't perfect, and so on. Let's see what he says. Veheyeh tamim. Mitzvah acheret, od binyan hazeh, this is another commandment in this topic, ketam tamim tiyeh mashem alokecha. Now this is another mysterious pasuk in Dvarim. Is this correct?
Yes.
Dvarim yutchet, 18:13, right? There, we once learned it. Do you remember? We once learned it, because Hashem said there, do not go after soothsayers and witches and fortune tellers and magicians and divinations, right? But rather, tamim tiyeh l'Hashem Elokecha. Be perfect, be innocent, be, you know, just follow blindly, so to speak, with great trust, without looking at anything else, what God wants you to do, right? Trust in God completely. Don't do those things. So about that, there's a great argument between the Ramban, you remember, and the Rambam, in which the Ramban The Rambam, let's start with the Maimonides, it's the easy one. The Rambam says that all of these divinations and all of these magicians and all of these fortune tellers, they're charlatans. It's false. Mm-hmm. There's no such thing. There's no such thing as extra sensory powers and all kinds of stuff like that. It doesn't exist. Hello, Edward. Hi, how you doing? How's it going? I just finished, but I'm in the middle of a class, a study group. It went, no kidding. Oh, so it was a long, hard day.
But it's not clear to me.
Ooh. Oh, yeah, I guess you did get to it, but boy, we had at the end only six cases and not seven. Somebody, Marsha, is just silly sometimes the way she schedules things anyway. That's not important for now. And only one of the second stage, and they were fairly simple, so only one complex.
How can I know?
And I got out sooner. But in order to make services, I took the charts with me. I was able to take all the photographs.
You
I was on the training program. Yes, I did figure it. I was fine. And I took the things with me, which I would do as soon as class is over. I'll take it.
No.
That's one of the benefits. I can do it from any place.
When you talk to studying Torah all the time.
That's right. Gradually, so I'm going to do that. If I really need help, I'll call you, but I'll try not to bother you.
Get to know.
I thank you. Thanks so much.
What you would like.
So the Rambam says it's completely stupid. Why does the Torah tell you, let's say if I told you 2 and 2 is 5, and the Torah will tell you, don't believe that man, he says 2 and 2 is 5. You don't need a commandment to tell somebody not to believe somebody stupid. Not somebody who's obviously out of his mind. So why should the Torah tell you, don't go after the magicians? According to the Rambam, if they're totally false, right? Why should the Torah tell you that, right? Go up in the street, you see these people with cards, and they give you all kinds of magic. So the Torah says, don't believe him. Don't follow after him. Yeah. I don't need to be commanded, right? But the Rambam says that the reason the Torah does it is because in their day, these people who know how to do this kind of show know how to control people. They find it in their power because of their charisma, to have people follow them, and then they take advantage of them to bring them to all kinds of immoral behavior, or to take advantage of them financially, or to imprison them, to dominate over them, right? Just like the Incas, for example, right? The chief, he had the power to whatever, speak to God and do all kinds of things, and he would make all kinds of tricks, and people would have to bow to him because he's the boss, right? So people who have the power of using magic can hold people in their power. So the Torah says, don't believe them. Don't go after them. Fine. They bring you all kinds of immorality. According to the Ramban, there is such a thing as magic. There is such a thing as telling future. There is such a thing as black magic that has the power to do certain things. The Ramban talks about it there in Tamim Tiyamatashama Lakaka. So if it really is true that I can go to you and ask you what's going to happen tomorrow, and what's the stock market going to do next week, and what does my father who passed away, what does he want to tell me, then you will do it, right? And you can actually do it correctly, right? So what's wrong with that? It's very good. Why shouldn't we use Eliyahu's powers? If it really is correct, right? If it is really worth it, does work. So the Ramban says that the Torah commands against it, particularly because the Torah wants you to be tamim with Hashem, your God. Not to take advantage, not to want to be assured with a certainty of a certain fact, but to trust God. It's an exercise in bitachon. Even though you could find the information, don't get the information. Incredible. The Ramban is very complicated. After all, where do you draw the line? Let's say somebody is smart enough, not because he's a magician, but he could tell you, the likelihood is that the stock market is going to do better this year, next year is going to do better. You'd listen to people who are advisors, right?
But if you listen to doctors.
Doctor, yeah, go to a doctor who tells you what the prognosis is of a certain thing. So there's, he must have a fine line. What's that?
Moses. Though some people believe that there was some magic artist, whatever. So many people follow him, believe in him, because they believe that they were seeing magic in Egypt. So 30 days later, he's seeing the same thing. So they believe that, oh, Moses is the same group of this.
They believe that Moses is a magician. Maybe that's why he had to die in the midbar and not go into Israel, because they will make him into some kind of a deity.
His face shone.
His face was shining.
Yeah.
Could make him into some kind of a holy man, right? Holy being. So he says, "Veheyeh tamim" is relevant to that pasuk of tamim tiyeh mashem alokecha. He has a comment on the bottom there. What's that then? Ayn od basabat Ramban sefer mitzvah sohem shekadar minyan zeh mitzvah zot nishtaveh Avraham Avinu kasher ba lichvot lo brit latet lo zera amar yitalech levayim demem ki mipnei shayah alav ha-shalom yesod ba-emuna va-cholek al ha-kasdim shayu mityachasim ha-kochot kulam l'shemesh ol-yareach l'kochavim v'u ra'a shiyesh alayim yotzer manhig siva od yitalech lefanav liyot tamim imo v'yo lo yiten l'vilbo sheyeh bezulat Shum emet velo yistakel b'inyanam klal im da'ato sheyotzro manhig otam ela yelibo elav levado yitale ki hu hamitzaveh otam v'mashalech marchatam v'katzonam. Alright, yeah, he says he applied this to Abraham. This comment on the middle, this is Ramban talking elsewhere. This mitzvah was given to Abraham because he saw that Abraham was disputing with the idol worshippers about the sun and the stars and the moon and everything, all the constellations controlling things in the world. He already was on his way to object to them, right? That he believes in the one God who creates them all. Here he emphasizes again, don't even have the slightest doubt or the slightest trust in any one of those forces, because I, God, am the one who controls all of them. Sounds like, according to the Ramban, it sounds like what the Abraham needed a little bit further strengthening in that regard. Because after all, you could believe that God created the world and that he gave the power to these things to do things, to control things. There are philosophies like that, right? That God is like an atheist, say that God created the world and after that he leaves it alone, and there are powers that God gave dominion over certain things. So he says to Abraham, don't believe that either, because I am controlling them all the time as well.
Because
so don't trust
that
either.
Because the astrologer said to him that you want to never have a child.
Mm.
Because the star of everything up there.
How would that work? What are the stars have to do with still having a child?
You mean you don't believe in astrology? Is that what you're saying? Well, neither do I. What kind of a question is that? You're right. The Medrash assumes there's such a thing as astrology, mm-hmm. with the truth about it. And Hashem was telling him, it is true, according to the fates, according to astrology, that you wouldn't have a child, but I am taking you and lifting you up from out, from under those forces. You are free of those forces. Other people, yes, but you are free of them. That's the Medrash. I mean, so that Medrash is according to the opinion that there is such a thing as astrology.
There is human forces. Created by humans.
No. Stars. You're born January 30th, like I was born, and then I'm an Aquarius.
Yes, we do.
And because I'm an Aquarius, then I'm going to have a certain kind of life and a certain kind of personality and a certain kind of attitude, and that's what it is.
That's what we are, queens.
But I don't believe that, right? I don't believe that. But those people who believe that say that this is true. And Hashem was telling Abraham, your stars have determined that Sarah is not going to have a baby. That's the way it is. except that I, God, I'm going to take you and free you from that force. So you're asking, how could it be? I mean, what's the question?
But what I'm saying
people
is...
People who don't believe in astrology say that you're right. No, it can't be. So the Medrash is false. The Medrash is nonsense.
Correct. But what I'm saying is that that force is not created by heaven, neither by Hashem. It's, that force is created by human.
How is it created by human?
They create an idea.
So you say it's false.
Yes. It's an idea.
No, those people who say it. Those people who say that it is true, then they say it's created by God. It's the way the world is.
They believe that.
Yeah.
Exactly.
I know people who won't hire people unless they fit into a certain kind of astrological sign. They'll only hire people who fit a certain influence by the stars.
That is what happened. What happened with
so that's that, according to the Ramban, is Asur.
That is what happened today with Kabbalah Center.
Oh yeah?
I'm receiving a lot of letters every single week saying that. Oh, today is Aquarius, the combination of this thing and combine Kabbalah and Torah and a lot of things. So focus.
Okay.
Things.
No.
I mean,
you're wondering how people can believe this, is what you asked the question. How is it possible that?
Something like that, actually.
So they would say, they would quote you Hamlet's statement to Laertes. They would say, there are many more wonderful things under the heavens than in your books or Horatio. Right? They would say, you just don't understand.
But I can understand that again, intelligence, force, God. Who knows what you're going on? If he wants your wife not to have a child, he can control that. But what is that?
Oh, these are fates. These are not desires. These astrology constellations don't have a will. They don't want your wife to have a child, or don't want your wife to have a child. If you walk through a door and a black cat walks in front of you, you are going to be cursed that day. Not because the cat wants to hurt you, not because anybody is evil here. It just so happens that certain things happen in certain ways. Like if you're born with an extra chromosome, you get Down syndrome.
Well, that I understand.
They would say, if you were born in a certain time when the moon and the stars are in a certain position, that will do it.
Well, then I get chromosomes.
They would say there's no difference between them. So it's just a fact of life. It's not because somebody's trying to do you in or trying to reward you. It's just a fact of life. If you're born in a certain way at a certain time, then you will be a strong, powerful soldier. You're born in a different time or whatever, you'll be a meek slave. Fate. Fate. Didn't deserve it. Didn't do anything wrong or good.
Right.
It's not a reward. It's not a relationship with the astrology. It's a fact.
Okay.
So he tells him, do not believe any of that. That there is this command over you. And that, but the Ramban is not like you thinking that it doesn't exist. The Ramban says it does exist. But you, Abraham, and your people are free of that. There is no Mazal Israel. That's what the Gemara writes. There's no Mazal Israel.
The truth is,
Mazal Israel. But the Frenchmen, yes, according to the Ramban. Yeah, I mean, he's an astrologer. He thinks that it holds water. The Rambam says nobody is under the influence of these things that are stupid. Right? Mm-hmm. People just believe it. They make it up. Like you say, it's a human reaction. Creation. But the Rambam is very complicated. He says, yes, there is such influences. But God freed the Jewish people from it. They are under his complete direct dominion.
Well, Ramban is not saying that this is created by God.
Yeah. Yeah, he does. That's what I'm trying to tell you. I understand. The Rambam, you're in good company because the Rambam agrees with you. I understand you. I'm sorry.
because I can't believe that these forces exist.
I understand. You and
gravity and
gravity is not the same because it affects everybody all the time the same way, depending on where you are. If you're in outer space, you have less gravity. All right, but there are forces. There are physical forces which are clear, right? So people who believe in astrology will tell you, you know that there are forces. It's just that we're trying to tell you that there are some forces that you cannot feel, that you just don't know. You know, like they would have to tell you there is such a thing as cosmic rays, right? The cosmic rays, you don't feel cosmic rays. They're running through us all the time. From the sun, they're just flying through us all the time. Okay. So you know that there are some things that affect physical bodies without being seen, without being understood. So they'll say, here's another one that you still don't understand. I mean, you know, it's easy to tell you this thing, right? Hocus pocus. You say it's hocus pocus, and they say, well, no, it's not hocus pocus. You just don't understand it.
It's like to say that Hashem is approving the demons, for example, when he's talk about the Seir or something related with
Seir. He created the universe with constellations, and he gave the constellations, the pattern of the constellations, influence over humanity and over everything that happens.
I forget an example. For example, why do we send a goat? To represent the sins of people. Why a goat? So she's telling us something about goats.
I can't believe that. For example, the moon has certain power over the surface of the earth. It's also at a certain time, p.m., the water is like living waters trying to get up using in the lakes. You can see that. 5:36 p.m. But it's
time.
He believes, he tells him, Abraham, you should believe that Hashem is above all those forces. He does good, even to those who are not under the mazal of good. And he could bring bad upon those even who are under the mazal of good. That's what he's saying. Hashem controls that, right? He will change it. According to the way a man walks before him, according to the way a person he does what God wants him to do, he will do what he wants to do with the person. He will cancel.
I can understand that.
He will cancel the forces of these magicians. And that's what it meant when he said to Abraham, go out from below your constellation. Free yourself from it. Go out from under the Ramban. There is.
Okay.
But you're getting out of it. Out of that influence,
okay.
Right? Who's that? Your little wife?
My little wife.
Your important wife. Where are you going?
The
bathroom. And Rashi, he says, explains this veheyeh tamim. You're still in the text, right?
Yes.
He says Rashi. He quotes Rashi there. You see it a little bit later. Keep reading about that.
The meaning of what these true believers in his heart that the Holy One presides. He alone is the all-powerful one. He is capable of putting events into action and of annulling events that were already set to occur. And consequently, one should not listen to cloud readers, diviners, omen readers, or sorcerers, And one should not believe that the words will surely come true. That's the main thing. If you believe, they're going to come to you. If you don't believe that words, nothing. Hocus pocus.
That's what Eliyahu said. Yeah.
Rather, he should conclude with certainty in his heart that everything is in the hand of the Most Superior One, who is El and Shaddai, and who can do kindness when it's not in the person's fate.
Right.
And
there is a thing, yeah, and do evil when it's not in
when the person's fate is good and favorable.
Yeah.
All in accordance with the extent to which the person has walked before him.
Yes.
He abrogates the omens of the exterrogators and makes full of the diviners. Isaiah.
Mm-hmm.
This is what the sages meant when they say that God told Abraham, abandon your astrology, etc.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Then he says, and Rashi.
Rashi interprets, be perfect as be complete in all the trials, all of the trials.
All the tests that I'm going to give you. So to him, tamim means, you're going to be under a lot of trials in your life. Hey, tamim means, be perfect with me, trust me, even when I test you. Having nothing to do with this business of the astronomer, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's a different one.
Mm-hmm.
And then?
And Rabbi Abraham ibn Ezra say that Abraham was to be perfect in the sense that he should not ask what the purpose of circumcision was.
Right? No, to be perfect, I'm going to tell you the milah, and that's going to make you perfect, and don't ask me any questions. In other words, this is a... You have a couple of lines coming up on the next page. Rashi and the Ibn Ezra. The Ibn Ezra is the one who said that Heyei Tamim has something to do with circumcision.
Mm-hmm.
Abraham. Mm-hmm. Is he Abraham there somewhere?
So according to Ibn Ezra, then it means be innocent.
Are we on the right page? No. Yeah. Abraham.
So be innocent.
Right.
Like the meaning of the similar expression in mind my her be innocent concerning your statutes. Psalms 1:9.
Right. So when you give me a statute, my heart should be perfect and innocent with you, meaning I should not question.
But the correct interpretation is what I have.
It's what I told you about tamim meaning to be trusting in God's ability to control all the events in your life and not to go after any other influences, not to believe in any other influences, not to follow their suggestions.
But one person believes that Hashem, but his faith is lack of some kind of bitachon, you know? So that means that the doubts that this guy has is going to make him an evil person, because he believed that maybe the guy that said to me last night reading the cards that today is Tuesday 13 and something bad is going to happen. He, in his heart, he's believing that something could be bad, but at the same time he's believing in Hashem and he's asking Hashem, please save me. So how can we deal with this kind of faith? Because it's not totally faith in Hashem. It's lack of bitachon, I guess. What do you think?
The Ramban is saying that there is a possibility that these things have power, but you are supposed to feel that God is the one who will take you out if you deserve it. He will take you out and reward you. And if you don't deserve it, he will be the one who decides what will happen to you. And it's not, you don't have to worry about the influences that we're talking about. Not to save me.
Oh, save me from the evil that could be happening. Oh, talking about Ayin Hara, for example.
Okay, according to the Rambam, it's not an exercise in bitachon. Right? They're very different, right? The Rambam, who says that these are all foolish things, and the Torah doesn't even have to command you, except that they're worried about how much control they can have on people by fooling them. So when Hashem tells you not to go after them, it's not an exercise in bitachon. because you know it's false. You don't trust God more or less just because some magician said that tomorrow you're going to have trouble. Because according to the Rambam, you don't believe him anyway. So it doesn't bother you. No bitachon issue. According to the Ramban, it's really a bitachon issue. Because according to those influences, you really are influenced.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to have bitachon that Hashem can and will overturn those influences if you deserve it, that you are his, you go after him. You put yourself in his hands, he will take care of it. Regardless, even though there are influences, according to the Ramban, then it's bitachon, right? Because you would be tempting to take care of yourself because they tell you, you know, tomorrow's a problem for you. And you are supposed to go into the next day tomorrow and say, I don't care what they say about the influences. They may be there, but Hashem is more powerful than those influences. He'll take care of them. That's bitachon, more.
It's interesting that the two great Talmidei Chachamim, the Ramban and the Rambam, had such opposite ideas about these fundamental questions.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And some people like the Rambam because he seems to be a little bit more modern and rational. And some people like the Ramban better because he's a little bit more, what should I say, emotional, spiritual. They like this.
And also
they feel that the Rambam is too cold, too logical, too...
Right.
You know? What is a religion that can be based on just logic? People think the Rambam is a little bit too dry. They like the Ramban because it's
right,
a little more also the mystical.
Mm-hmm. The fact that the Ramban has a interesting idea about the Mashiach.
Oh, you remember, yeah, about the world changing and fundamentally. Remember, that's also the Ramban, right? Mm-hmm. Animals will be friendly with each other,
mm-hmm.
and children will play with the snake, and you know.
And the Rambam says,
and people's hearts will be changed so much that they will not even desire to do bad. They will just be naturally good all the time. And they won't get any reward and punishment anymore because they are just like completely good. So you don't give a person rewards for doing something good if he is programmed to do good. Ramban. We read it. And the Rambam, on the other hand, says that's not true, the world is going to be the same as it is now.
And that seems to be reflected in the in Gemara, in Machlok is Rav and Shmuel or something.
Yeah.
Shmuel says something, Ein Bein Olam Hazel, Olam Haba,
peace and freedom from subjugation. That's the only difference. That's Shmuel.
Right.
I see. So he's like the Rambam. Right? And Rav disputed that?
I'm not sure.
I don't know. I don't know who it is that said otherwise. Yeah.
But, so, they're all
two very different.
Right.
Two very different opinion attitudes, right? So that was a very worthwhile thing to do. Kitalech lefanai veheyeh tamim was good. Both two mitzvot. Right? And was there something else that had, you remember Yishmael's thing?
And Sarah.
Yeah.
Constantly from Sarah.
Yeah.
He has a discussion also that righteous people in this world do not believe in their righteousness. And they always are worried that maybe they do something that will be improper and not good, and that will take away their reward. And that there are some tzaddikim in this world who receive fate that is like evil people that get. Why do some righteous people suffer in this world, right? You believe that evil people should suffer in this world, not righteous people. So mm-hmm. he says there are some tzaddikim who suffer in this world just like evil people do, maybe even more, right?
Mm-hmm.
So he discusses that in chapter 15, verse 2. That might be interesting. 15:2. Of course, that's a real problem, right? Remember what Abraham said to God, 15:2. Let's say you read 15:1 and 2, Perek 15, Perek Tedvav. Hashem said to him, "Listen, Abraham, don't be afraid." Al tira Abraham, don't be afraid. Verse 1, see? Anochi magen lach, I protect you. Schachar be'meod. Your reward is great. Much. Very great. Right? Hashem tells him that. Abraham answers him. What does he say? Vayomer Abraham, Adonai Elohim, mati tengli. What can you give me? Vani oleth hariri. And I am going childless. And ben Meshek Beiti, the servant of the manager of my household, who de Meshek Eliezer, he's going to... I don't have a child. I have a foreign manager of my household. He's going to inherit me after me, right? Mm-hmm. So everybody asks a question here. God had already told him before, he's going to have a child. You're going to have a child. You're going to have many children. And your country that I'm giving you, Eretz Israel, is going to be inherited by those children, right? So when God now tells him, don't be afraid, I'm with you, I'm going to protect you, and you have great reward in the future, ahead of you. And Abraham says to God, what can you give me? I'm walking around childless, and Eliezer is controlling everything. So you don't believe God that he told you what he's going to do, that he's going to do you good things?
Because your actions...
That's the problem. The problem is, what kind of answer does Abraham is giving to God when he tells him that? Right? So in this pasuk, the Ramban obviously has, everybody has to explain, how could Abraham say that when God is telling him, much reward is ahead of you and you're going to have children. He says, what can you give me? I'm going childless.
And he's 100 years old.
And he's 100, of course. It's not very likely that he's going to have children if he's 100 years old. So in pasuk beit, Vayomer Abraham mati tei hine, he tzaltani min malachim, aval min ha-kareit lo yiftachta oti. Rak amarti shetarber li zachar harbei, umay yeli zachar belo balim. So he claims, until now, that there are no children promised yet. Abraham is saying to him, you did protect me from those kings. He had just finished the war with Lot. Mm-hmm. However, you have not, and you told me I have much reward, but what good is reward to me if I have no children? Let's see. Abraham did hear from God. I'm not making it up. In chapter 12, go from this household, Lech Lecha, va'erescha legoy gadol, I'm going to make you a great nation, and so on, right? And then a little bit later, in chapter 12, Pasuk Zion 7, Hashem says to Abraham, listen, to your seeds, to your progeny, to your descendants will I give this land. So what does it mean? What does Ramban mean, he did not yet? He could say that he did not yet get a promise of children.
When he say that, I will make of you a great nation, we can understand that.
Children. Yeah. And Pasuk 7, look at verse 7. The Unor.
Yeah. And in 7,
Pasuk 7, yes. Verse 7.
Hashem appeared to Abraham. Mm-hmm. Abraham answered, to your descendants I will give this land.
So how can you say that he doesn't have a promise of descendants?
It's promising, yeah, the children.
So he's saying, what good is any reward to me without children? Let's go on with the Ramban. I don't understand it, right? Aval min ha-kareit lo yiftachta oti. You have not yet promised me not to be cut off without children. Is that what kareit means?
I think so.
So you have not told me that I will not be like that. I don't understand how that could be. But anyway, right? So therefore, what kind of great reward are you giving me if it's not true with children? And then he says, "V'halalo adam da'ato." He, Abraham, did not imagine, did not consider that this great reward that Hashem was talking about was for the world to come. Right? The Ramban is trying to say something. What is bothering Abraham? He's saying, you can give me a lot of rewards in this world. Money, and servants, and camels, and sheep, and good food, and everything. But what good is that to me if I don't have children? That's what he said, right? Now, if Abraham would think that Hashem's promise of a great reward is the reward in the world to come, everlasting life and the closest to God of his soul after death, if he thought that that's what Hashem was promising him, then he would never complain, what good is that to me without children? Because that's the ultimate good. It's the best good. Even children or no children. Mm-hmm. Right? So, the fact that he is complaining to God, what good is this reward to me without children, means that he did not think that God is promising him the world to come as a reward. Because if he thought that, he wouldn't ask this question. Why doesn't he think that? Why doesn't he think that? So one answer could be that he might not believe there's such a thing as a reward in the world to come, so he's not thinking that God promises it. But he's saying the opposite. Listen to what he says here. Kizeh ein tzorech la'avtacha. He knew very well a person gets a reward in the world to come. I don't need a promise for that.
Right.
We talked about it. Why? Ki kol oved Elokim yimutze chayim lefanav. Every servant of God will find life. It means to say everlasting life before him, with God. Ach be'olam hazeh. That is obvious. You understand? The Rabban is saying that's obvious. Don't have to be told that. But in this world, there are some tzaddikim who suffer like the evil ones do. Therefore, they need bitachon, or they need a promise of the reward, right? So Hashem is saying to him, you're not going to suffer like some evil people do. You're going to have a good reward. In this world, he meant. And therefore, he could say to him, "What? I don't need any reward in this world if I don't have children. And he thinks that when Hashem says to him that he will have great reward, he means to say both this world and the world to come. That goes war for perfect tzaddikim without any punishment at all.
Yeah, also, I killed them. That's a contradiction to the promise that
of having children.
To Yitzhak.
That's the enigma of the
Akeba.
He didn't complain then. That's always a mystery
of how come he didn't speak up. My question is what he had done, I think it was said. I think he would have said, okay, that's where you are. Goodbye.
Yeah. I see.
I know.
It doesn't jive with some of the tefillot you had in Kippur this past. We beseech God to look at us favorably because of the readiness for Abraham to overcome all hesitation and to do but he wanted in that regard, despite his compassion and his pity on his son. Seems like at least the way the prayers are arranged and the way he beseeched God on the merit of the Akeda, it sounds like we assume that he was ready to go all the way. And that Hashem had stopped him. Which is a mystery. How could that be? But it sounds like.
I don't see how he could pass a word. I mean, they can give him another Yitzchak.
Yeah. I don't know. Whatever. You could have a bitachon, but that's another time, another way. Skip just a little bit. V'yesh alecha lishol. He's asking the question we asked. You skip about two lines, three lines. V'yesh alecha lishol in the last part of the line, number seven. Yes, and you could ask, he says, shekvar ne'emar lo Avraham ki et kol ha'aretz asher et ha'ro'eh etnena lezaracha ad olam. Vesamti et zaracha ke afar ha'aretz. Hashem had already told him about Zera. So how could Abraham now say, I don't have any children? He's going to have children.
He's going. But
at this point.
He has a Shmuel. Okay. Shmuel is going to be a tremendous nation, as we know. But that's not what he wants.
Ishmael is not yet born. Ishmael is not yet born.
Well, maybe.
Chapter's not just 17 coming up. He is born in the chapter later. So if you see that, you see that the Ramban is asking the same question we asked. How could you possibly say that he's not going to have any children in his mind when Hashem already promised him he's going to have children, right? How could he say now I'm going to chart this? Why doesn't he believe in the promise that he got until now, right? And the answer is, so he doesn't contradict what we said. Hashem did promise him children, and now he's saying, what are you going to give me? I don't have children. They don't have confidence in themselves, and they think that maybe they have transgressed without intention. He's not even aware that he might have done something wrong. And therefore, Hashem had said, this is a Pasuk 95, comes from you, Jeremiah. I have promised and I have spoken to this nation and to this kingdom to build and to plant, and meaning that everything's going to be good. And they returned from the good way and they did bad in before me, and I changed my mind on the good, about the good that I told them I would do. Right? So in that way, Avram could say to himself, yes, it's true that originally Hashem had promised me to have many children. And I, unfortunately, it might be, since I'm not having children in the meantime, it's taken a long time and I'm not having children, it's possible that I have been undeserving. And that his promise was conditional. And since I have done maybe something wrong, I didn't meet up with his expectations, I won't have children. Right. And now Hashem is telling me, you have great reward. And since I haven't had children until now, and I think, I believe maybe I don't deserve to have children, I could say to God, I don't really need a great reward, because while I don't have children, the rewards are not meaningful to me. Right? He's not complaining. According to this, he's not complaining. He's acknowledging that maybe I don't deserve it. Even though God promised him.
He didn't take the booty from the war.
Yes.
But that's interesting.
That's right.
He's interested in children.
Right. Mm-hmm. It so happens he's not a poor man anyway, you understand? I mean, it's not that he needed the food. Okay.
Right?
V'hine ra'a atzmo baba yamim. So he sees himself as an old man already. V'lo nitkayma nevuato. And the prophecy that he had about children is not coming true so far, right? V'chashav ki chatav manato. He thought maybe his sins, his own transgressions, have kept him from the good. V'ulai chashash ata penye enash al nefashot sharat b'div kidivei ravotenum. Listen to this, right? And he thought maybe this war that I just had gone on, right, to save Lot, I killed a lot of people. Might come to the Ramban. It's a very interesting thing that you could maybe consider that cause for punishment, even though it was a righteous war because they captured people and they took booty and prisoners, and one of them was his family, and he was going to war to free them. So it seems like it's a righteous war, and in a righteous war that you end up killing people, Avram could legitimately worry that maybe in that he killed too much. He killed what he could have done without killing. He would have. This could be something wrong there. He could still doubt. And maybe he would lose the rewards that he had been given.
Mm-hmm. Promised.
Wow. In fact, he quotes a Medrash Rabbah, Bereishis Rabbah, that says that maybe he was worried that even among those people that he killed, even if it's proper, maybe one of his children and children's children's children is going to be a righteous man, a good man. So I have stopped the possibility of something good coming to the world, even though that person may have been bad, which gives you amazing, I mean, Musar HaSkel, right? I mean, you don't rejoice when people are killed, even if it's necessary to kill them, because it's a tragedy. For example, killing somebody when he's about to knife somebody in Yerushalayim, you're killing somebody. Don't want to talk about that, right? Ukalashon hazeh amru b'reishit rabba v'yira Yaakov me'od v'yetzer lo mikan she'in atachal asavim v'lo'am abba. You remember, he's quoting another one. When Yaakov was leaving his home and coming away, Hashem promised him, listen, I'm going to take care of you, I'm going to be with you, I'm going to bring you back to your father's house, whole and in peace. He said that. Then later on, right, when Yaakov goes to Laban, and then when he comes back, and Esav is about to meet him, it says that he became very frightened and very panicked, and he was suffering from this panic. And he thought he was going to get killed. So, Yaakov, what's the matter with you, right? You had a, remember that dream that you had with the Sulam? Hashem told you. It's going to take you back safely to your father's house. So you're supposed to have confidence and be tachon now. So, nevertheless, Yaakov was frightened and didn't trust in the promise. So everybody gives the same kind of explanation there. He said, I've been away for a long time. I didn't do kibud av v'aim. I didn't take care of my father and mother. I might have done something wrong with regard to Laban. I may have transgressed in some way or another. It's true that Hashem promised me, but maybe I don't deserve the promise. Mm-hmm. And now it's not going to come to me.
Right.
So tzaddikim, he's saying, frequently do not have confidence in the promise Hashem gives them for good things, because they may feel that they may not deserve it anymore. Now, it's a very complicated issue, because usually, you know, the Rambam, you remember the Rambam about Nebuah? If Hashem sends a prophet to say to people something good is going to happen, you can take it to the bank. It's going to be good. If a prophet comes and tells you, God told me that there's going to be punishment, then you don't have to believe him, because you just have to do tshuva. It's conditional. The bad things don't have to come. But good things will come from the prophecy. That's a tradition that we have, right?
However,
here is a prophet who is told himself, you're going to have good. However, you're going to have children. And he now thinks, well, maybe it won't come true because I didn't deserve it.
However.
Yes.
What about the Holocaust? I mean, But with that Holocaust, I mean, one of the men was told everything is going to be nice in Eretz Israel, and their grandparents are going to sit and we'll see the grandchildren playing around. And,
so it's not the Holocaust, you mean? Okay. The destruction and the exile from Israel.
Okay,
right?
We had that, and
well, the answer to that is pretty simple. Did you say Kriyat Shema tonight?
Yes.
During Davar Ma'ariv and this morning too?
So two times.
Two times you said Kriyat Shema this morning also, right?
Yeah.
And there's a second paragraph of Kriyat Shema, you remember? It says, V'hayayim Shema tishmu v'amitzvotai yasher anachim yisraetem hayom v'avayit Hashem lakam v'adol v'chol v'avakam v'chol nafshachem. And if you perform all the mitzvot and you carry out Hashem's mitzvot and you serve Him, then I will give you rain and I will give you this and I will give you that and you will eat well and you will eat, right? And remember, however, Yishamer lecha, pen yiftel levavchem, be careful lest your hearts deviate and you begin to worship other gods and break my covenant with you. I want to tell you that the rain will stop. The heavens will stop, you will be leaving this land and you will be chased away from it. And I want you to teach that to your children, that this land is conditionally yours only if you follow my ways. That's clear. Conditional. But when God gives a promise in Dvarim, I want you to know, after all those terrible things have happened to you, you are going to return and you're going to do tshuva and I will take you back to your land. The Ramban says that promise has not yet taken place. We're not talking about Bayit Sheni. That has not yet taken place. That we can take to the bank. It's going to happen. That's going to happen. There's one day we're going to do tshuva, one day we're going to be deserving, and one day Hashem will restore all that we had lost. That apparently is a fact. Is it not possible that that is also conditional, that you can also break Hashem's covenant then and also lose it? I mean, how do you understand the principle that they say that a prophecy for good is definitely going to happen? The Abraham was given a promise of children, and he now could feel, maybe that promise was given to me only because I was then deserving, but now I'm not deserving. That's what he's saying. And that's why he could tell Abraham, he could tell Hashem, I know you told me I'm going to have children, but here years have passed, I'm already 100 years old, and I'm not getting children, so it must be that I don't deserve it. So you're giving me a reward without children? I don't want the reward without children. Hello? Hello? How are you, Judy Kims? I don't know why I'm echoing. Am I echoing?
Yes.
No. I am in the shul learning. This is actually the tail end of an hour. We've been at it a little more than an hour. With Pinky and Eliyahu, we once again got into the groove and we were learning some of the Ramban. That's true. Are you there? Okay, so that is fine with you? Do you want to go away for supper or do you want to be home for supper? Okay. Whatever is easier for you. Good. See you soon. My Judy has just called me, and it is an hour and something since we started. We just finished our Ramban. Mm-hmm. I think it's troublesome. I don't know.
Just
explains what he's telling to him, right? Some people have explained, he says, because I'm going to die without children, right? And I believe that at first he will complain, he's complaining, what good would any reward give me if I have no children? And I am traveling around the country alone. He doesn't mean die without children. I'm in the meantime, I'm alone. Nobody is going in and out of my house except Eliezer, who is a foreigner, and right? Maybe Avi, and he's not from my own household. And then he said, you didn't give me any children, like you promised me. Yeah. And I am punished and have lost my merit that you had promised me in the beginning. Basically, he's elaborating the same thing that we have said, that he believes somehow that he has lost his merit that was the deserving of the promise at first, and now I don't have the merit, and I'm sad, I'm going around the world alone, I don't have anybody, but he's complaining, he's sad.
So that means that we easily, or it's easy for us to believe that the good promise could fade away, that the bad promises could stay?
No.
Because of lack of faith?
No, bad promises can be definitely erased with tshuva and tefillah and tzedakah. That bad gzeirot can be canceled.
Yes, but
that's for sure.
Yes, but Jacob was
good.
Great.
He was afraid, because even though he had a good promise, that's the promise. That's the problem. It's trying to explain. Everybody agrees bad promises don't have to come true. We used to think that all good promises do come true. And now we see from Yaakov and Abraham that at least people like them, tzaddikim like them, have doubts in themselves all their life that even though I was promised, maybe my transgression will make me lose the promise.
That's the easy way for us to understand or to give reason to maybe bad merit from us. What I'm trying to say is, it's easy for us to understand that bad things come to us because something happened between us in our behavior. But we lack to believe that the good promise can come true.
No matter what.
No matter what.
He's saying that Abraham and Yaakov did not believe, didn't feel that. Yeah, we always think that we have God in our pocket. You know?
Yes.
Once he promises,
we are happy that way.
Set.
Yes.
We're set. No problem. That good promises always have to come true, and that's the sign of a prophet. If a good promise he makes doesn't come true, then he's a false prophet. And here is a suggestion that a good promise doesn't come true.
And you see, in the same way, Eliyahu, he was fleeing from just about.
Things came out good for him in the end. For Eliyahu and Abraham.
Is that all?
She was in the corner of that.
Yeah. He liked
it. But,
Baruch Hashem, may Hashem bless you.